Kim Douglas.
Hi, Debbie and Mark. You know how the soap stars always have that perfect smile like Susan Lucci all day long? Well, many women are a little afraid because their lips are small. I've got the perfect thing to get you big lips and no injections or shots.
Someone else with perfect solutions, Paige Hemmes.
That's right. I'm here in the craft room, and I can't wait to show you what I have planned. It's so fun being a soap opera star, but it's also fun pretending to be one and making a DIY scrapbook just like this, inspired by our wonderful guests today from All My Children.
Yes. And making sure you look like a star, Laurence Arian.
Now, everybody knows that Susan Lucci's Erica Kane was known for her attention-grabbing fashion. Today, I'm going to show my lucky ladies at home that all you need are the right pieces to make your own style statement.
Wow. All so dramatic.
You give them a little bit and they take a mile, okay? Welcome to Home and Family. It is Thursday, people.
It's Thursday.
We have a fabulous show. She has been with us all week. You should probably know that by now if you've been watching. She is special. She is a guest. She is a co-host. She is Susan Lucci. Not only for us, but for her, because she's brought along some very dear friends of hers, reuniting the cast of All My Children for the first time since the show ended. Wow.
Thank you. Amazing.
This is amazing. Thank you so much for making this happen.
Sure.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah,
thank you for saying yes, really. You're making our dreams come true, as well as people's at home, and of course our audience here. But La Luce,
we've gotten to know her over the cup.
I don't know if you know, but she's La Luce now. Yeah. You know, you were the only one there from day one for all 41 years. And looking at your cast, I can't even call them your cast. These are your family. Looking at these people, what do they mean to you?
How lucky me that I was there from day one, so I got to meet and work and be with all these amazing, amazing people. This is the first time we've all been together.
Yes. Yeah.
The very first time. This never happened before. And we've had a chance to hug and kiss and laugh. You know, and we would spend 12, 16 hours a day.
Raise your hand if Susan Lucci was at your wedding.
Baby shower. Right.
Baby shower.
First, second, third, fourth, any wedding, pick one.
Right. Okay. And how many weddings were you at for Erica Kane? That's the real question.
Well, while you all are a cast of characters, you wouldn't exist. Pine Valley would not have existed without one special lady, and that lady was Agnes Nixon. And for people, there are, everybody knows, and if they don't know, they should know this woman and who she was. Who, for those who are watching or going, I didn't know who she was, because she was really behind the scenes.
Agnes Nixon created All My Children, created One Life to Live, Ryan's Hope, and she was a visionary. Mm-hmm. She was a genius of a storyteller, full of humanity, and no cardboard characters. I think that's one of the things about Agnes. She told a story that was character-driven, but all the characters, we all had flaws. We were all fabulous in some ways and not in some other ways. And I think the audience recognized a piece of them in each of the characters. She was also a pioneer. Agnes changed the face of television, daytime television for sure, but all of television, because of the stories that she chose to portray, and she had to fight for them. She often fought for years with networks to allow those storylines to be told. And because we had the opportunity to be in your homes 5 days a week for an hour every day, we all had the opportunity to play those storylines that were complicated and real in real time. Mm-hmm. So that was really a gift of the genre of daytime television. And Agnes was the brilliant one to fill our lives and those pages, those wonderful scripts
it was,
and got to tell
was
the story. Agnes was also a mentor because she was the first really truly successful businesswoman in my business that I ever witnessed. And so I watched her, how she balanced career and raising her four children. And her home was a home.
Wow.
Her home was not some, you know, thing you're going to put on reality TV.
Right.
Or
exactly.
I mean, her home was a home, and there were roots and traditions. And she loved her children, and she loved her work, and she made it all happen.
Well, I'll tell you what, she was a trailblazer. She literally was a trailblazer in every sense of the word. And in 2011, when All My Children came to an end on ABC, Agnes actually spoke about what the show had come to mean to her. Take a look.
Right.
At the beginning of the show, I wrote something in the Bible that I presented to the network. I said, the great and the least, the rich and the poor, in sickness and health, and tragedy and triumph, you are all my children. And that's what I feel today. And I wrote it, well, it sounded good, but I think after 40 years, I understood what I was trying to say at that time. And I love the show and all the people on it. And no matter what happens, we all live in Pine Valley.
We said goodbye to Agnes in September, but the groundbreaking stories that she told, she actually crawled into our lives because she really was able to sort of shake the trees and find out what people were living in the world that they live in that period of time. And it still resonates today in many homes across this country. And for many of the stories that existed, they revolved in many cases around, with all respect, Erica's dysfunctional family.
Yes. But you put the fun in dysfunction.
Yeah.
You really did.
But what, through the years, how did you see Erica? How did family become meaningful to her?
Well, family was always meaningful to Erica. And don't forget, we were telling stories that Agnes had written. Mm-hmm. And Agnes understood the value of family. And although Erica's family and many of our families were dysfunctional, we were trying to be functional. We're all trying.
Through the food fights,
right.
All of it.
But Erica was more self-centered than many. But she still valued family very much. Her dad left when she was a little girl, and she felt she wasn't lovable. And she tried to fill that hole.
10 times.
Ten times.
Let's take a look. This is some highlights of Erica as a mother.
One more. Push. Bear down. Push.
That's it.
Yes. Erica, yes. Erica, your baby is born.
You really do take after your father.
Bianca better pray she takes after her father. Anything is better than to inherit from you.
Don't you dare talk about my daughter, Bianca. If I ever catch you anywhere near her, I swear to God, you will rue the day you were born as much as I do.
Have you always loved me, Mom? Have you?
How could you even ask me a question like that?
Do you love me now?
Bianca.
Do you?
Yes.
I'm gay.
Can I just walk over here?
Yeah.
To watch and then to watch you all here live watching it back. Oh. It was clearly a very emotional scene.
And it's still very current, you know?
Yes,
still very,
very current. I mean, Agnes was always right on the cutting edge, and she fought to tell stories that she thought needed to be told. And that was one of them. It was very near and dear to her heart, and she poured her giant heart into it and told the story with humanity and with respect. And yes, it does still resonate today, and it is still quite moving today.
Yeah, and you presented it with humanity and respect. How much respect you gave to that scene, both of you.
Well, I remember being called into the producer's office at the time, Jean Burke.
Yes.
And Jean told me what storyline they had in mind, that Agnes had written that she wanted to tell this story. And at the time, we hadn't seen the character of Bianca, and there was no one playing the character because she had not been on the show since she was a very little girl. And they told me the storyline. And the fact that so many teenagers and people in their early 20s who come out to their parents feel that they won't be loved anymore, so they'd rather commit suicide than come out to their parents. Oof. And so the producer, Gene, and I both sat there. And just, I thought, and I said, oh my God, what an honor to be part of this storyline. And please just be sure that whoever you cast in the part of Bianca is a young actress who gets it.
Right.
Who really gets it and who is spectacular. And my goodness, there could be nobody more perfect for this part. Aww. Get it.
It was truly an honor and to be a part of the story and maybe the thing in my career that I'm most proud of course. And I still hear from people all the time that it changed their life. It saved lives. Right. I received letters from young people whose parents had turned their back on them or who did not feel it was safe to come out of the closet and tell them who they were. And once their mom, who had never met a gay person in her life, saw Erica go through the journey, and it was a journey from learning and not being able to handle it to ultimately acceptance to being a proud mother of a lesbian daughter.
I watched that scene online, and this is what I was telling you.
Yes.
The layers that you peeled away between the two of you without saying what needed to be said, and the rejection and the nudging, and you see me and you don't. The acting was brilliant. I mean, it followed the words that you guys had on the page.
Thank you so much.
And on a side note, someone else who changed your life in real life, who cast someone in your life, is Cameron Mathison.
Yes!
He actually was responsible for casting your husband for real.
Yes,
that's right.
And he's responsible for two beautiful boys that I'm a mother to Jack and Henry. And if it hadn't been for Cam, Cam introduced me to one of his closest friends growing up, this Andrew Miller, my husband. And when Cam told me that Andrew was his gold standard, his moral compass, I knew that I had to take this guy seriously.
What I really meant by that is all the other guys that I knew in my life, I wouldn't let her go near. You know what I mean? Like, this is the guy, okay, yeah, he's, I think I'm right, you know what I'm saying?
She got hitched by omission.
He was like, he was the guy. But he was the guy, he's a great guy, he still is today. Yes, it's some of the best work I have ever done, thank you.
Were you hoping they would hit it off, or you were just trying to help a buddy out?
I kind of knew. Like, I kind of had the sense. I remember the night really well. We were out, and it just kind of, like, happened, like, right there in the moment a little bit. I was like, this one, this is going to be magic.
Right.
Nice. Well, and it was.
And Cam was at our wedding. He spoke at our wedding.
Yes.
He was in our wedding party, and is Uncle Cam to my kids.
Aww.
So we are family now.
We really are family.
Well, let's go back from the present. Let's go back to the 80s for a minute, with the big hair and the big shoulder pads.
Boy.
There was another family drama with Erica's family. It was involving her brother, Mark, who is married to Kathleen Noone's character, Ellen. This was a storyline that started off with all the love and all the romance that they wanted to see, and it led down to the road of addiction.
Mm-hmm.
And Kathleen, it's nice to have you with us.
Thank you very much.
This storyline came with such conviction, it needed to be told.
Absolutely.
Why?
It did. Well, you have to understand, at that time in the 80s, in New York City and around the country, the drug problem in this country was rampant. And Agnes, of course, in her inimitable way, wanted to deal with it through family. Mm. So not just, you know, have someone have a problem with drugs and then they're sent away someplace. What was important to her, what I felt, and Suze, please fill in if you feel that anything to add to it, is that she wanted to talk about how the subtleties of the dissolution of the family and how it affects everyone that you are in contact with. We had a very loving relationship between the two of us, and slowly that began to change. The character would, character of Ellen would notice, you know, the differences in him, his lack of attention, his not being present, any of that. So Agnes did the scene itself, the intervention scene on air, and this was such a powerful scene of all of us confronting his issues in the hopes of getting him to get help.
Right.
And how it affected people is that the National Basketball Association, the NBA, saw our show and requested that we give them the tapes of this because they were trying to instill upon their young players what the effect would be of them taking drugs. Wow. You see, so Agnes's work, was just far-reaching.
Was far-reaching, and also, again, Agnes put that storyline in the hands of brilliant actors, Kathleen Noone and Mark Lemura, who played Mark, did such a brilliant job. I'd love to share his work with all of you so you can
see. Let's take a look.
Mark, she thinks you're hooked. She's not going to listen to anything that you say.
I'm not an addict. I'm not sitting here with the DTs. I like a lift every now and then. I don't have any tracks up my arm.
Okay, but you are sitting here with a broken hand and a wife who won't talk to you. Now, Mark, if you're not an addict, you sure got your share of problems.
Mark, it's okay. It's all right. Mark, it's all out in the open now. It's okay. All the lies, all the deceptions, it's out. And now, we can start dealing with it.
Mark, listen to me. You have taken the first step. The first step, Mark. Look around you. You're not alone.
No.
These people are just like you. And look, they're fighting. They're fighting to get over it, to make their lives better. They're not giving up, Mark. And we won't let you either. Do you understand? We love you too much for that.
This show saved, you guys saved lives, I'm telling you.
You know, we're talking about Agnes Nixon and her ability to keep building on family. Years later, Erica has some addiction issues, and Mark Lemura comes back and serves as an addict, as somebody who's been through it, to help his sister. And so it was, she never finished a storyline.
Well, she started several. Yes, actually, we're going to talk about super couples when we come back.
Yes, we are. When we come back, we are going to be reuniting some of Pine Valley's most popular pairs.
Of all time. Welcome to Pine Valley.
I love that.
All these years later, and it still is alive and well.
Yeah.
And actually, right in front of us, we left you talking and teasing about super couples, which this cast had plenty of. But before we get into that, let's get on the same page. What makes a couple a super couple?
I have to say, I really think that that's up to the audience.
Right.
I think the audience has a relationship with the people. They have a chemistry with the couple themselves, and the couples, thank God for great casting.
Right.
Well, you know, then there's a chemistry between the people who are the couples, but it's in the audience's hands.
Yeah, I think. Well, the writing, too, plays into it as well.
Oh, my goodness, yes. The stories that are being told, exactly. But, yes, the writing gets the audiences to care, but if it's not cast well, the audience doesn't care.
Well, we got ourselves some couples here.
Yeah. I think some good casting was Greg and Jenny. Do you guys
agree? Oh, my goodness, yes.
That was great casting, Kim Delaney and Laurence Lau. We have reunited them here. So I'm going to ask you then, why did the audience like Greg and Jenny? Susan?
You know, I don't know. I can't figure it out. Honestly, I think definitely, of course, each of these beautiful, wonderful actors who brought themselves to the parts. But I think there was a Romeo and Juliet component, definitely. Mm-hmm. Larry Law's character, Greg, came from a well-to-do family, from all the right side of the tracks and all that good stuff. His mother didn't approve because Kim's character, Jenny, came from the wrong side of the track, so to speak. So there was that. And I think people in real life certainly can identify with all of that.
Absolutely. And you guys had some pretty romantic moments.
They were pretty awesome.
Yeah,
we're going to show everyone at home. Just to
get
remind
your fan
you.
Out. Get your fan out.
Remind you some of these romantic moments. Take a look.
Family, your house, everything.
It's like I said before. We may not come from the same backgrounds, but we share important things, like feelings.
Well, you sure know how to make me feel better when I'm upset.
Well, you make me feel good, too.
Those whom God has joined together, let no man put asunder. Gregory, you may kiss the bride.
Saw the magic there, but you know what? It really translates when you leave the set and then you go out into the public, and you're like, okay, I just left my job there, let the work, you know, lunch bail at home. You guys actually had a horrible. I when I read this and saw this experience that you guys had, you were doing a sort of a meet and greet in Florida.
Yeah, it was a personal.
I don't remember it. That's so funny. Yeah. I just got through life.
Well, it's called blocking it out.
Yeah, exactly. Selective memory.
So I didn't it was know a very they loved you. What wasn't? Go ahead.
It was totally traumatic. We were invited down to this brand new mall in I think it was Tampa, and they were expecting about 500 people, maybe 1,000 to show up. They had a little tiny stage with a couple of mics, and two security guards. Well, 6,000 people showed up, and they were totally overwhelmed, and the microphone system did not work, so we could not control the crowd with our voices, and they began to. Muscle in toward us, they broke down the ropes and stuff like that, and it got kind of scary. They were pounding and shouting and screaming. Some girl in the third tier, those big open center court areas and balls. On the third tier, she screamed and everybody looked up and she flashed us. That's not the traumatic part. It was kind of stunning, but the security guards, decided that for our own safety that they needed to get us out of this. But there was no place to go. There was no back door.
Yeah.
So we had to muscle.
That's where my claustrophobia comes
from. Yeah. We had to muscle through.
I've had that forever.
These thousands of people to get to the elevator, the glass enclosed elevator that went up in the middle of this center court.
Oh, so they could all see where you got.
They could all see. Yes.
Exactly.
And people were grabbing Kim and grabbing me and pinching us in various places, and.
Well, the fans, the soap fans are very loyal and, a little bit rabid. Yeah. I mean, you guys are big fans.
Yeah, yeah.
They don't call them fans for nothing.
Yeah.
And what really sent them into a tizzy, Kim, was when you decided to leave the show. So Agnes Nixon wrote your character off in a tragic jet ski accident. Mm-hmm. Let's take a look at this.
I think that would be shot a little differently now.
A little bit.
Filmed a little differently.
A little bit, but
cut to the close-up. Cut to the side.
What a way to go.
Blown
up on the jet ski.
Yet they kept you alive for a couple of weeks in the hospital, hoping you'd reconsider.
Agnes wanted me to reconsider. I just wanted to go out and try new things. It was my first job ever acting. And I just was young, and I wanted to try new things, If I knew then what I know now, I would have stayed and renegotiated. It was just something to do. I needed to try new things. They kept me in the hospital bed for a couple of weeks trying to talk to me.
Well, there's another super couple that we have to mention on all the cast here. The coupling of Edmund and Maria, they were played by John Callahan and Eva La Rue. Was there a point when you kind of cross over and you go, I don't know what happened, but I think we're a super couple now?
Right.
Like, is there a point where you go, oh, yeah, I'm on every news or magazine cover?
No, I think we were still kind of shocked when we got invited to Super Soap Weekend as a super couple, and we were like, oh,
I think you were a super
couple.
Wow.
Oh my gosh, this is like really exciting. We're the super couple. Yeah.
I'll tell you when I figured it out. We were walking down Broadway, and cop pulls over. Oh. My background, I start to run, but I'll just be cool. He pulls over. You two guys, whew, great.
Really? Oh my gosh.
Oh, that's perfect.
You guys end up blurring the lines because you fell in love in real life too.
Yeah.
It's true. It's true.
Our daughter is so bummed she couldn't be here today because she's like, Mom, I'm a product of all my children. She's had the flu for 4 days and missed so much school that I made her go to school.
We have a beautiful 15-year-old. It's true.
And you were treated to the most beautiful, perfect wedding. You even said it, Eva, the most perfect wedding in 1994 on the show. That magical winter wedding. Let's take a look.
Snowed sideways for 3 days prior to that, and we thought, oh my gosh, it's going to be a blizzard. On the actual day, it was 70 degrees because you could see I was wearing a strapless gown. They had made this gorgeous overcoat for me, but I didn't end up having to wear it because it was 70 degrees, and we're like, oh, it was beautiful. Yeah.
Budweiser called. They want their Clydesdales back.
They'll be at the Super Bowl, don't worry. It was in Susan's hometown, and she sent us this beautiful cake to the set. Yep. She was lucky she didn't have to be there for the 16-hour shoot day, but she sent us a cake saying, welcome to my hometown, and thanks for, you know.
Oh, yes.
It was really sweet.
Wedding, and you look gorgeous.
We were already in love at that point, and that was really a fun day for us. So.
And Peter, not to be left out, you were also part of a big super couple. I mean, you married the same woman four times.
Four times, yeah.
Yeah, just.
4 times in 10 years. He knew what he wanted.
Yeah.
He just couldn't keep it. Yeah.
Cliff and Nina. What was so great about Cliff and Nina?
Cliff and Nina, you know, it was kind of this gothic storyline, you know, the very protective father, the daughter, again, Agnes Nixon, the daughter had diabetes and was dealing with problems and suddenly needed to have some surgery. And there was a young intern there who Palmer wanted nowhere near his daughter, and it kind of started the whole thing. She was a brand, like Kim, she had never had another job as an actress, and she had wonderful instincts. She was a lovely, lovely actress. And
a beauty.
And it kind of worked. Yes. And I think everyone would agree that when you're in it, you don't really know whether it's working or not. Oh. You find out, as Susan said, from the audience.
Yeah, exactly.
So true. We were all trying to make it work, but then you find out it's really working from someone else.
Yeah. And boy, was it working, and the audience responded to you. And actually, Peter, I have a little surprise for you. Will the real Nina?
We're gonna let these two hug it out for a little bit. We're gonna come right back, and we're gonna actually head into the kitchen and get caught up and have something to eat. Don't go away. What a fun day this has been, a wonderful experience getting to see you all reminisce. And it wouldn't be possible if it wasn't for one lady, one fabulous lady who created all my children, Agnes Nixon.
Yeah.
Sadly, we said goodbye to her this past September. She was 93 years young. What a beautiful spirit. And she was writing her memoir right up until the very, very end. She was still putting pen to paper or whatever she was doing to write. What does that say? about her?
I think it says that she was a born storyteller and the best of the best and loved what she did and just had to tell us the story, and thank heaven she has.
Yeah, thank heaven she has.
Yeah, she was really signing off on her book jacket cover, as I recall.
Was she really?
Yes, and then...
And then she passed.
Yes, that night in her sleep.
The book is available, I think, in March, is it? Did I read that somewhere?
It is.
Yes. Absolutely.
Yes, it is. And we have two very special people in our audience that I know you would like to introduce.
Would be my extreme pleasure. We have Bob Nixon, Agnes's son Bob Nixon is here. Her beautiful, wonderful daughter-in-law, Sarah Nixon, who has been close to her. So good.
What a wonderful woman. And we also have another face in the audience that I would like to acknowledge, Rosalind Allen, who played your conniving Silver!
I don't know, but she used to leave her lingerie in my boyfriend's drawer and then act like, oh!
Well, Rosalind didn't. Silver did.
Right.
Yes. Silver. Let's be clear.
Fine. So as much as Agnes was just a pioneer and she really did see so many things in the future, she didn't like something that Larry did. An interview that you gave that kind of upset her?
Yeah. I was early on the show. Maybe it was like early 1982, and I was on the show a couple of months, and someone, I was talking this to an interviewer of a soap magazine, and she asked me about my character, and I just kind of in a joking way said, yeah, you mean the Dudley Do-Right of daytime television, you know?
Yeah.
And she said, oh, that's a funny line. I'm going to write that down.
Which is kind of, for those who don't know that.
The Dudley Do-Right of daytime television. And I wasn't really serious. I was just kind of like, you know, doing an alliteration, you know, and I was having a fun time. And I didn't know she was going to publish that. Okay.
Uh-oh.
Well, she publishes it, and then my executive producer, Jackie Babin, called me into her office one day, and I'm going, well, what does she want, you know? And she goes, by the way, Agnes, she read a comment that you made about Greg Nelson, and she was kind of upset that you would, like, treat with disrespect this character she created.
Wow.
And I was like, oh, my God. I was just, it slayed me to think that I would, that I had hurt her feelings for one thing, and I really liked the character of Greg Nelson, but so I wrote her back. I said, listen, I'm so sorry that this came across that way. I have great respect for Greg, and she wrote me a letter back saying, Greg has a moral compass, and that means a lot to me,
mm-hmm.
and I so appreciate what you're doing with the character, and thank you so much for your letter.
Step in front of the camera other than, I guess, maybe an extra here or there. But near the end of the run of All My Children, Agnes guest starred on the show in the role of a Pine Valley resident, Agnes Eckhart. Mm-hmm. Take a look.
Hello, Agnes.
Erica.
Oh, it's been way too long.
Oh, indeed it has.
I understand you had a close call with some bad berries.
Bad berries, but I had a wonderful near-death experience.
Oh, my. But you're on the mend, and I'm sure you'll be back out there in no time. I'm gonna let you rest.
Well, Erica, first, I want to tell you, I saw Mona over there.
My mother.
Wow. She was talking about your mom, Mona.
Okay.
Well, when we come back, we are gonna honor some other Pine Valley residents who had to leave us and go see Mona and go see so many others over the years. Come on back, everybody. Welcome back, everybody. Before we went to break, we saw a clip where Agnes was referencing passing away and having seen Erica's mother, Mona, played by the wonderful Fra.
Fra. Frances Evelyn, called Fra. I'm sure that Agnes is with Mona right now, with Fra. And Fra was very special to me. She played Mona. And from the very first day, we were paired together for our audition scenes. And it was a mother-daughter relationship, unlike any other. That was also Agnes. She, before that, mother-daughter relationships were very reverential. Mm-hmm. This one was much more realistic. There was some knockdown, drag-out fights, which every 15-year-old girl has with her mother, and my own mother and I would laugh at these scenes because, you know, you could see what was going on. But Fra, who played Mona, was so experienced as an actress. She had been on stage with Charles Laughton in England. She came from Oklahoma, and she was that wonderful combination of being very rooted and very warm and also very, very worldly and experienced and sophisticated. And she was very inclusive and very funny.
Very
funny. And she could do crossword puzzles in ink.
Oh!
Oh, wow. That's a statement.
That's amazing.
Well, listen, smart.
Pine Valley was filled with so many wonderful characters and personalities and talents through the years. And some are no longer here with us, but let's take a moment and honor their contributions.
So scared of getting sick. I'm scared of being dependent on you. But I'm most scared of leaving you alone.
Of my mind, misty watercolor memories of the way we were, scattered pictures of the smiles we left behind. Smiles we gave to one another for the way we were. Can it be that it was all so simple then? Or has time rewritten every line?
Friggin' would we? Could we? Would we?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
In a heartbeat.
Well, also, Annie Mira is not on that. Remember, Annie played,
of course.
I will tell you, it's
Ben Stiller's mom.
Many tears flowed in Pine Valley, I'm sure.
Yes. Yeah.
They continue to. You guys, this has been such a wonderful
thank
moment.
Thank you so
thank
much for being
up the
here
pages
with us.
Of your lives.
Thank you so much.
I mentioned it earlier, for a chance to receive a copy of Agnes's memoir, My Life to Live is what it's called. It goes on sale March 21st. Visit our Facebook page and we'll have more information there. We're not done yet. We have a little pet that needs a home.
Come on back, everybody.
All My Children legend Susan Lucci is here as guest host all week long.
I'm so excited to be back on daytime TV and without any lines to memorize.
And speaking of All My Children, you have so many guests coming.
Oh, it's going to be a reunion like you've never seen.
Join Susan Lucci for an unforgettable week.
On Home and Family.
All this week at 10 on Hallmark Channel.
Welcome back, everybody. Just because we cannot get enough cute kittens around here, it is time to check in with our Cat Center moment of the day. Prepare for some cuteness.
Hallmark Channel's Cat Center brings you a Kitten Bowl 4 update.
Welcome to Cat Center. I'm Mary Gorilla.
And I'm John Sterling.
With just a few weeks away from Kitten Bowl 4, let's take a look at this week's top tackles, hits, and hisses.
Defensive cat Jalapeno was a little hot under his collar. Check out some of his best defensive plays.
Boomer's Bobcat's hissing bolt chooses to use a different tactic of intimidation, hissing. Oh, Mary, that's, I guess, how he got his name.
No kidding. And then there's Julius Peepers, who has a bit of a split personality. While one side is cute, the other is mischievous, ready to tackle anyone who gets in his way. That's all the time we've got. For John Sterling, I'm Mary Gorilla.
For more Cat Center updates, go to catcentertv.com. And don't miss Kitten Bowl 4, Sunday, February 5th at noon, exclusively on Hallmark Channel.
We are a family. We go from cats to dogs around here. It's just that simple. Suzanne, who do we have?
Well,
He's named after my grandson, Xander. He's a two-year-old Yorkie mix. And he's so chill. Everyone here fell in love with him. And he's available at Wilder's. So last week, someone was watching the show, and they ran down. And an hour later, our last dog from last week is adopted. So,
so wonderful.
Oh, Xander.
Oh, so cute.
Aww. You guys, thank you so much for coming here and spending the day with us and just showering us with all your memories. I mean,
if you could have seen the looks on your faces looking at each other, it just spoke volumes about what you mean as a group. So it's wonderful. And I hope the surprises worked.
Yes. That was the best part.
And Susan, we get to keep you for one more day.
Yes.
Lucky me. Thank you.
Come back tomorrow. We'll have more of Susan with us. Also with it, we have an amazing giveaway. You ready?
Yeah.
We're going to do this again. It was so big the first time. We're giving away another car.
Yeah.
We'll tell you all about that and the details tomorrow as well.
Just like Oprah Winfrey, you get a car, and you get a car, and you get a car. And also from Dancing with the Stars, your partner, Tony Dovolani.
Okay, home and family, all my children, backstabber, take one.
I'll be right there for rehearsal. I'm just running to my dressing room really quick. Excuse me. What is going on here? Exactly what do you think you were doing, Susan?
Darling, please. It's my show now.
Oh, really? Does Mark know about this?
Sweetie, hi. Hi. Uh-oh, you're gonna love this. I think we should get rid of this. I love the gold. It goes so well with your Emmy. Come and look.
It's true.
So fantastic.
Oh, Mark,
come on
you're
up and
so
look.
Thoughtful.
It's fantastic. You go try. You check it out. It's good. Wonderful stuff. We don't need that anymore. Oh, hi. Oh, would you?
What?
Yeah. And for, we don't need this either. Hey. Okay. See, careful. Watch yourself.